Thanks, Lana. And I'd like to thank Mark for a plug on our session today. And first of all, before I start, I'd like to acknowledge all the traditional owners on the lands on which we're meeting today. So tonight I'm Lachlan Francis from the Arthur Isler Institute for Environmental Research at the Victorian Government's Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning. And tonight I'll be talking about some research myself and my colleagues, Dr. Alan Robley from the Arthur Isler Institute and Dr. Bronwyn Hrantzi from the University of Melbourne, undertook evaluating state-funded FoxNet programs across New team, the Victorian Government spent at least $4.3 million on fox control programs. These were typical fox control programs aimed at biodiversity responses and generally undertaken to best practice methods. These programs would have ranged in small to large scales with differing baiting frequencies. These programs also would have had limited, if any, allocation for monitoring. Our objective was to evaluate these state-funded programs to see if we could generate a list of recommendations based on what we thought were successful programs. These recommendations could consider things like the spatial layout of the bait stations or baiting frequency. And these recommendations could then be used to guide future investment in fox control in the state. Before we could analyse these projects for success, we first needed to define success. It's a two-step process. Firstly, we required programs to have an average fox density reduction of greater than 65% across a defined area of conservation interest. Basically, where are you trying to control foxes and how good was that across that whole area? This 65% target was derived from a Jim Hone paper investigating the rate of increase in mammals and specifically foxes and the reduction required to stop population growth. The second step in our success criteria, we required the programs to have a reduction of greater than 65% in fox density over at least 50% of that defined area of conservation interest. We could calculate fox density reductions at the square kilometre scale and then how are these distributed across that area of conservation interest. Within the model, we measured success at the end of the project's specified funding period. So basically, were these projects expected to be successful or not within the allocated time period? We gathered data from 15 projects across the state, ranging from 11 to 8,500 square kilometres. These programs had a range of baiting frequencies from single pulse through to continuous year-round baiting, and their spatial layouts varied from linear programs like a linear strip or a perimeter baiting through to network baiting on internal tracks and roads. These projects also covered various habitats across Victoria, from the dry desert country in the northwest to the wet forests and coastal heath country in the south and elsewhere in between. To analyse these programs, we use FoxNet. FoxNet is a customisable, spatially explicit, individual-based fox population modelling tool. It generates foxes in the model landscape, which inhabit that model landscape, just as you'd expect foxes to. We can import that landscape directly from GIS software to replicate the program landscape. We can then set fox survival and reproductive parameters suitable to that landscape. Within the model, the fox behavior is determined by their age, sex, status, and the time of year. Are they mate searching, breeding, etc.? And then critically, we can incorporate individual baiting programs within the model. We can incorporate the individual bait stations or baiting sectors and their individual baiting frequencies throughout the year. Within each case study, we had 40 iterations of a baited and unbaited scenario, and these predicted the fox densities in each. We then calculated fox density reductions in line with our success criteria. So firstly, what was that average reduction across that defined area of conservation interest? And what was the reduction within each square kilometre within that area of conservation interest? Here's an example of an unbaited scenario with the dark green areas showing high fox densities across that model landscape. And here's a baited scenario, and hopefully you can see the dots representing bait stations on your screens. And the lighter green colours here are representing lower fox densities. And here is an example of the model analysis, where I've generated here a heat map showing the fox density reductions, with on this map here, the dark red areas are showing the greater than 65% of fox density reductions, or that second step in our targets. We then analyze this map output against that area of conservation interest. In order to generate some of our recommendations, we also added experimental strategies to the modeling program. So these investigated increased baiting frequency and improved spatial layouts. So for projects that may not have met the two steps in the success criteria, we look to increase their baiting frequency to a consistent year-round baiting program. And then if we could, we also look to improve their spatial layout where possible, which wasn't always the case. As an example of an experimental setup, here on the right, we have the current strategy for this particular program, which was a network of bait stations on internal tracks, but sectors being baited at different times throughout the year and different frequencies. Our first experimental strategy for this program was the addition of private land baiting proposed adjacent to this park. We maintained the internal baiting program within the park and then added on this private land baiting adjacent. And our second experimental strategy for this program was we maintained all bait stations both within the park and the proposed private land baiting outside of the park and increased their frequencies to a consistent year-round frequency throughout the model. After the addition of the experimental variations, we had 15 case study programs with an additional 16 experimental variations. So here are results for our current strategy models, or what happened on ground. On the bottom, on the x-axis here, we see the spatial size of that area of conservation interest for the programs, and the y-axis is the average reduction in fox density across that defined area, or the first step in our success criteria. Here we see the single pulse programs were generally smaller in size and had low fox density reductions. Multi-pulse programs were slightly larger, but also still had fairly limited fox density reductions. The continuously baited programs, however, were also larger in size and generally had increased fox density reductions. Now, taking the programs which met the first step in our success criteria, we then could analyze them against what percentage of their area of conservation interest had fox density reductions of greater than 65%, or the second step in our success criteria, now shown on the y-axis. As you can see here, one project met both of our success criteria, with three others close by. We can generally see on these plots here that increased baiting frequencies generally lead to higher fox density reductions, and that it's also difficult to do small programs well. The exception here is that small, highly successful project, which was bounded on two sides by ocean, which greatly reduced the fox immigration onto the control side. Now, looking at the results of the experimental strategy models, well, these were the models that didn't meet the first step in the success, didn't meet the success criteria in their current strategy. What we see here is a general increase in fox density reductions with improved baiting frequencies and improved spatial layouts. And taking the projects of this experimental batch that met the first step in the success criteria, we then analyzed them against the second step. And again, we have one project which met both steps in the success criteria with two others close by. I'll note here that there are two projects which received generally high average fox density reductions across their area of conservation interest, but fairly limited spatial results. These projects had fairly concentrated fox density reductions leading to these lower spatial results. Here are the results for that experimental strategy we walked through before. So for the current strategy, with its mix of baiting frequencies within sectors, it generated a fox density reduction of 51% across that area of conservation interest, but limited spatial results. When we added the private land adjacent, we saw a minor increase in fox density reduction within the park, but very similar spatial results. With an increased baiting frequency across all bait stations, both within the park and that private land adjacent, We saw an increase in the average fox density reduction to 68% and an increase of the spatial reductions within the park. With all modelling projects, there are limitations to be aware of, and we had three main limitations. Firstly, we don't have home range information for every landscape across Victoria. Within the model, the fox home ranges, the fox densities are linked to home range size, and we couldn't incorporate every home range size to be suitable to each landscape within the model. We also haven't replicated fine scale habitat use by foxes. We know foxes will use roads and tracks as thoroughfares, and this is also where the majority of bait stations will be located. But we haven't replicated that behaviour in the model. And thirdly, better information around bait encounter rates and mortality would be beneficial. We know that when foxes encounter baits, some will cache baits, the baits can degrade rapidly in the environment. But better information on how that encounter rate leads to mortality will improve the model. Now, after analysing our 31 projects, we generated a list of recommendations based on project control size. So if you have a project aiming to control foxes in an area less than 300 square kilometres, we recommend a network of bait stations based at less than 500 metres and baits to be checked and replaced at least weekly throughout the year. For control areas between 300 to 1,000 square kilometres, we recommend a network of bait stations spaced at 1 kilometre intervals with baits to be checked and replaced at least fortnightly throughout the year. For control areas of greater than 1,000 square kilometres, we recommend a network of bait stations spaced at 1 kilometre intervals and baits to be checked and replaced at least monthly throughout the year. And critically, all our most successful projects had continuous year-round baiting. And hence, we recommend that any fox control's frequency of baiting needs to be both continuous and ongoing to have the greatest chance of success. There is a growing body of evidence in the utility of simulation modelling in conservation, and this work further adds to that. For our needs, the FoxNet modelling was most useful in providing insight into predicted fox control program effectiveness. We have used the model to refine or develop fox control strategies for organisations interested in improving or developing fox control programs. And this has been most useful in areas with challenging time and space requirements, like the Alpine Country of Victoria. This work can be used to inform future fox control policies in Victoria to ensure that funding goes towards programs with the greatest chance of success. The model also provides testable predictions for evaluating effectiveness in the field. And we're also extending the FoxNet model outputs to be used in conjunction with habitat suitability model to provide insights into threatened species populations responses to different fox control strategies. Thank you for listening. I'll take any questions if there's time.
All right. Thank you for that, Lachlan. That was very interesting. I can't see any questions popping up in the Q&A at the moment. I do have one quick question for you. We've only got about a spare minute, but is there any ability for the model to then look at, once you've figured out the reduction possible with the effort of baiting, does it then look at the population recovery and what effort is required to maintain population, or how the population might recover if you stop baiting or keep baiting, either way?
Yeah, good question, Lana. And yeah, certainly the model will continue to simulate that. So, and that's exactly what we did with this modeling, was we baited the programs for their funding period, and then we also continue to baiting them for a second funding period to demonstrate that extended benefit of fox control. And then we then continue the model for another 4 or 5 years after that, and we're with no fox control, and you could see the fox populations, you know, gradually increase back up without that fox baiting in the landscape. So most certainly we can use the model to look at that sort of the recovery rate within projects post fox control.
Okay, Excellent. It's all very interesting. Thank you.
No worries.